According to the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, in Oklahoma, a person dies from suicide every 11 hours. And it is the second leading cause of death for people ages 10 to 34. Those are startling numbers and the subject of this week's in-depth segment with Susan Cadot and her guests.
Thank you, Rich. Yes, we have three guests who are going to help us address this very important topic across the entire state of Oklahoma. I'd like to introduce them to you now. We have Senator Kay Floyd. She is in the Oklahoma Senate, a Democrat from Oklahoma City. We have Whitney Bryan, who is an investigative reporter for Oklahoma Watch here in Oklahoma City. And then Julie Geddes, who is the Senior Field Representative, Suicide Prevention Specialist with Oklahoma Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse based in Norman. I'd like to thank all three of you for being with us today.
Happy to be here.
Thanks for having me.
Senator, I want to start with you. I have some numbers I want to recite for our viewers. In 2020, one Oklahoman committed suicide about every 11 hours. Suicide is the ninth leading cause of death in our state, putting Oklahoma as a top 10 state in deaths by suicide nationwide. Senator, you've been in the legislature nearly 10 years, first as a representative, now as a senator. To what would you attribute these terrible numbers?
You know, Susan, it's such a complicated issue, and it's such a complicated answer. And let me just full disclosure here, start by saying that I do not have a mental health background. I was an administrative law judge for 23 years before I ran for office. And I became involved with suicide prevention for our children my second year in the legislature, where I was approached by some teachers and some parents and some healthcare providers about suicide prevention for our children. And that's how I became involved. I know that this is an incredibly complex issue. I think you have probably people on this panel that are much more able to answer that question. Julie knows this topic upside down and backwards, but I can tell you it is complicated. Oklahoma consistently has a higher rate of suicide than so very many states in the country, as you just pointed out. So it's complicated. We've seen it exacerbated with COVID in some parts of our state. We know that if you're able to get help, mental health support, you'll see numbers in the rural areas where they don't have that kind of support are different from the numbers you see in the urban areas where you do have that kind of support. We know that data shows that as far as youth suicide is concerned, that we have even things as like a parent being incarcerated can increase the stress on a child. So it's the stressors, but I appreciate the question, but I think honestly, Julie's very qualified to maybe do a deeper dive on this one.
Well, let's tag team and hand this one off to Julie.
You know, when I first started with suicide prevention, I was the director of Teen Line, which was a hotline for kids. And I had a lot of calls from all over the nation from kids calling about, I want to kill myself. I don't want to live anymore. Just many, many kids that were struggling. Suicide is very complicated. And I know that's not the answer you want or what you're looking for, but it is, because we're all unique. We're different. We think differently. With our federal grant, we consider 10 to 24-year-olds as youth. What we know is that the human brain is not fully functioning. It's not developed until the age of 24. In fact, the numbers for youth specific rise about the age of 18. And I think about all those, you know, school is a protective factor for kids, because they have that connection. But again, kids don't have really good problem solving skills, or they don't have that trusted adult in their life. They don't know that they should have one. You and I should have a trusted adult, you know, and if you don't have one, you should get one as that person that you can talk to that help you through whatever you're facing. We're all different. Suicide, we know, is multi-determined. It's not just one thing. It is a combination of at least two, maybe three things. Thank you to the new Senate bill that we now have as law. I have high hopes that that will help. You know, I have high hopes that people will actually take this very seriously, because, you know, suicide is preventable.
I just wanted to say, because you mentioned the bill, I want to lay the foundation here, and then we're going to jump into the senator's bill and what it addresses. Whitney, with Oklahoma Watch, you have been working on this issue, doing a story on this issue. What can you tell us that you've learned?
I started requesting numbers from the medical examiner's office this summer. The medical examiner investigates every suicide in the state. And so we requested those numbers because, you know, when COVID first started, I was hearing from mental health experts across the state and around the country that, you know, that was going to create more mental health challenges, which was probably going to lead to more overdoses, suicides, and things like that. So we wanted to see if that was the case. And it was here in Oklahoma. We saw a rise in suicides in 2020, about a 10% increase from 2019. But as we dug into those numbers, you know, what I found was this is not a isolated problem in the pandemic. These numbers have been increasing pretty drastically over the past 15 to 20 years. You know, I went as far back as 2006, which the medical examiner has total suicide numbers for in the state. And we found that since 2006, Oklahoma has seen a 62% increase in Oklahomans who have died by suicide. So in 2006, for comparison, there was 544 Oklahomans who died by suicide. And in 2020, there was 883. And of course, some of those, you know, mental health experts are attributing to the pandemic, to isolation, increased anxiety, fear of the infection, and of course, grief, you know, from losing loved ones to the pandemic. But it's not just the pandemic. You know, experts are also citing things like, you know, in Oklahoma, we have a high rural population, which the senator pointed out earlier. Rural communities tend to have higher rates of suicide. Care is less available to residents in those communities. We also have a high Native American population in Oklahoma, and Native Americans also have a higher rate of suicide than any other minority group in the United States. And those, of course, are just a few things that are contributing to what we've been seeing in these increased numbers.
All right, Senator, having laid this foundation, the situation in Oklahoma, you presented a bill and it was just signed into law. Will you tell us about that measure?
Actually, there's a little bit of history to that. In the language that was changed with my bill was language that I introduced when I was in the House of Representatives, the original language in 2014. And originally the language had a mandatory preventative requirement that all teachers and staff at all of our schools in the state would receive mandatory suicide prevention training. Mm-hmm. And it was going to be provided by Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services at no cost. And I ran into a lot of opposition at the time. And there were a lot of members of the House who did not want to impose a mandate on the schools. It was something that for the few years before I got there and the 2 years I was in the House seemed to be a really big sticking point, was how many mandates were constantly being imposed upon educators. And so this was seen by some as just one more mandated requirement for the teachers. So I changed the shall mandate to a may, and we put it out there. And the districts did with it what they chose to do. The local control portion of that, I completely agree with. However, I felt like this was such an important issue and such an important problem in our state that we could overlook that. But I was overruled. So it did go through as a may instead of shall.
Well, you having said that, turning a shall to a may, which makes it optional for teachers, correct?
Yes, that's the way the language was when we went into this session.
I have some information from the State Department of Health. Oklahoma's youth suicide rate is 9.4 per 100,000 of the population. That's compared to the national rate of 7.3. And as Julie or the senator mentioned earlier, on average in 2020, two Oklahomans ages 10 to 24 died by suicide every week. In Tulsa, calls to Family and Children's Services COPES hotline, and COPES stands for Community Outreach Psychiatric Emergency Services, on behalf of suicidal children have jumped 31% in just the last year. What would you say to instructors who now have an option, Senator, to train themselves to help the young people that they spend so much time with every day?
Well, suicide, as you point out, is not getting better. I mean, it's not, the numbers aren't going down, the numbers are going up, and they're going up in Oklahoma. And so there was a lot of support this time to go in and change that language and make it mandatory training for all school districts across the state. We've got data from the CDC that says that it's the second leading cause of death for ages 10 through 24 in the country, second leading cause of death. It's not gotten better nationally, and it certainly hasn't gotten better in Oklahoma. So I had a lot of support. I had teachers that were calling me and were supportive of it. Originally, we had language that was going to require that students in grades 7 through 12 receive training. We took that out, and then I put it back in, but I made it effective next year and not this year. So we'll train the teachers this cycle, and then the training will be available, a different training, but a training for peers so they can, young people, they can recognize problems among themselves and with their peers.
Well, it takes a village, and students certainly spend a great part of their day at school. So this is wonderful. But Julie, would you not agree? There's training that some parents can undergo, family members, to at least alert them to the signs that something might be right. What can parents look for?
I think parents have to be very aware of what's going on with their child. They need to have a conversation, 10 to 15 minutes every day. What's going on with you? How are you? I mean, any changes? And when a child is struggling, there's a big hesitancy, I think, to go seek mental health services. And it's so critically important. It should be done early instead of an emergency. So if people, you know, if you think about yourself, you have a full plate. What I call the full plate is you've just got things that you just pile on it, all these tasks that you have to do. Kids have the same thing.
Right.
And so when you want to get them when it's early so that you can help them. And if you can help them at that point in time, they may never be suicidal again. You don't know. And so we have to do a better job. Parents have to. We have to. If we see something, we've got to help them.
I think that, you know, the point that I think is being made here and what I found in my reporting is consistent is that kids who are struggling, kids who've experienced trauma or are struggling with mental health or other things, they need support from positive adult role models in their life. And certainly those adults often come from the school setting, school counselors, you know, teachers, school staff. Those are great places for kids to have that support system. But of course, parents, family members, you know, older siblings or community members, church members, these types of support systems can be found, you know, all over the community. It's just a matter of stepping up and, you know, providing that support. You know, in addition to Senator Floyd's bill, we found several different programs that have been implemented recently to sort of help to provide that support, right? So in the bill, you know, you're training teachers and school employees to provide that support to students. Over the summer, the State Department of Education funded about $35 million to schools across the state to increase the number of school counselors that are there to treat kids who are struggling with mental health. So those are not positions of, you know, test proctors and scheduling, you know, details and things like that. Those are supports for kids who need, you know, mental health counseling and help. And then we also found out that the Department of Mental Health has recently partnered up with an organization of veterans who is reaching out to veterans across the state. They're doing gun training, and they're also recommending that veterans, you know, hand over basically for safe safekeeping, any weapons that they might have in their home, any firearms, if they feel that they're struggling with mental challenges. And so there are a lot of efforts that are underway to try to give support to young people, kids, as well as adults inside and outside of the school setting.
All right. Quickly, Senator, you were having three interim studies this summer looking at different aspects of suicide. Are those completed? And can we look for more from you in the future?
They have not been completed. We haven't had any of them yet. I'm doing three. One is a deeper dive into youth suicide here in the state, and to find out exactly if it's possible to find out the main causes, and also to look at the demographics, gender, race, geographics, economic, and just see how all these factors play in. The second one is an interim study on child death, but it's not by suicide. So it's two studies, one death by suicide and one is death by drowning, fire, automobile accidents. And those stats and that information comes every year from the Oklahoma Child Death Review Board that we have in the state. And so it's important to me that we get sort of an overarching view of if our children are safe or what's killing our children. And so it's suicide and then it's accidental death. And then the third one is a joint study with Senator Julia Kurt, and it's going to be pediatric deaths and COVID.
I'd like to thank all three of you for joining us. You can find out more by checking out Whitney's story on Oklahoma Watch. OklahomaWatch.com, is that right, Whitney?
It's .org.
.org. Mm-hmm. Okay, you can check that out there. And I'd like to remind everyone, you've seen the number on the bottom of your screen, the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, 800-273-8255.